some creative people to come in, new animation, new stories. I have that.
Okay.
That engine is already working. It's already pumping.
Okay, my fans, they want this done.
They do.
So you guys got a deal. Let's go.
For years now, Black indie comic creators have been fighting to make it onto the main stage. And in 2021, leading into 2022, it seems like they are now getting the respect they deserve. Many have been waiting for this moment to rise and are sprinting towards the finish line. In their wake are up-and-coming Black indie comic creators who are following behind on the trail they have blazed. Aaron here from Black Anime on Concept Moon Network to talk about the growing dominance of Black indie comic creators and why you should definitely be paying attention. As co-founder and CEO of Concept Moon Studios, Brandon Diddley puts in his podcast with Black Anime,
they're dying. Mm-hmm. Dying. Like,
that's my
look on it. Like, Marvel and DC is dead. Like, and it's time. This is the time for us as indie creators, Black, whatever, to really step our game up and kind of fill that void, because people aren't really going to them for quality stories.
The time for DC and Marvel to be your only options for the comic book medium has long passed. Indie comic book companies have been achieving the same quality as the main duo, and in many cases outdoing them. In fact, due to some of each company's terrible policies, they could be credited for creating the same indie companies that now exceed them in ability and at times sales. Image Comics was created by Todd McFarlane, Jim Lee, Rob Liefeld, Mark Silvestri, Eric Larson, Jim Valentino, and Wilsh Portacio. All creators whose contributions we can still see at Marvel and DC till this day. Since the creation of Image Comics, they've been dropping heavy hitters for decades now, such as Spawn, Savage Dragon, Witchblade, The Walking Dead, Invincible, Saga, Jupiter's Legacy, and Kick-Ass. And they aren't the only ones to divest from Marvel and DC to create their own companies, with not only better books, but with better policies that benefit the creators. However, I'm not here to talk about them. Although many Black writers and artists have found success working at the bigger, whiter indie companies, there's still a lack of representation for Black people behind the comics, inside the big boardrooms where decisions actually get made. In Sci-Fi's Indie Comic Spotlight article from 2020 by Karama Horn, who's also known as the Blur Girl through her podcast and socials, she discusses the inequality that Black creators experience in the face of big indie companies and DC and Marvel. According to a recent Lee and Low baseline diversity study, publishing as a whole is still very white and very male. Although some progress has been made, the comic book industry suffers from the same problem. Even with the success of movies like Black Panther and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, as well as TV shows like Black Lightning and HBO's Watchmen, comics featuring well-written Black characters and comics created by Black creative teams rarely exist in mainstream or indie comics, with the exception of creator-owned work. Even when the stories we create become major success for the wider companies that employ us, we are still sidelined and heavily scrutinized. Our contributions are minimized, and any stories concerning people that look like us are looked at as risky. It's even bad to the point that we aren't allowed to write about characters that aren't Black unless we issue a major protest. And when we do want to write a Black character, there's a danger of being used as a consultant for a white writer to write them. Horn writes about these two experiences happening to two Black creators. In fact, Christopher Priest, one of the architects of Milestone Media, who has also written Black Panther, Deathstroke, Spider-Man, and countless other characters, famously refused to work in comics for years until he was authored Deathstroke, a white character at DC. At the same time, calling on Black creators as consultants for Black characters written by white writers is just as problematic, says Joseph P. Illich, executive editor of Heavy Metal Magazine. Don't talk to me about Storm and then give a Storm series to a white writer, informed with my Black perspective, he says. And this is really just the tip of a giant iceberg on why being a Black creator within these majority white spaces is incredibly difficult. During Milestone Media's first run in 1993, DC acquired the publishing rights in an effort to diversify its reader base. This would essentially backfire, since retailers and main white audiences saw the new titles come from Milestone and dubbed them as Comics for Blacks. Milestone was shut down its comic division in 1997, temporarily ending really the only publication at the time focused on telling Black stories. Milestone would continue making the Static Shock animated series that received high ratings and viewership, but would still be canceled in 2004 because of low merchandise sales. The big two and big white indie companies weren't getting it done then and still aren't getting it done now. So what's the solution? Maybe it's what Dwayne McDuffie said in Milestone Media's 1993 interview with Wizard on Wizard the Comics Magazine number 20. In response to Wizard asking about if black creators are only good at writing black characters. One of the stronger arguments for what we're doing is that I don't think it's Marvel or DC's responsibility to provide stories about African American males. It's an area of interest to me, but it's not their job. It's my job. Towards the end of Horn's article, she discusses how many black creators have turned to crowdfunding to self-publish their works in lieu of going through traditional publishing. With the crowdfunding model and social media access, many creators are not waiting for the comic industry to find them. Instead, they're developing their own audiences and creating high-quality comic book series on their own. With the advances in social media technology, black creators have figured out that the big lie that the big comic companies were telling them was just that, a lie. People not only wanted more black stories, but they hungered for them, like gamers standing outside of a GameStop for a new hyped up video game. Their audiences were ready and waiting, and black creators have decided that standing on the sidelines were no longer an option for them. On January 7, 2022, Manuel Godoy, Giselle Godoy, and Tanis Durrett went on Shark Tank to pitch Black Sands Entertainment, a black-owned publishing company started in 2016 by Manuel Godoy and his wife Giselle. This appearance on national television would spark a conversation that black comic creators had already been having for years, that our stories were in fact profitable. After going back and forth with the world-renowned Sharks, Manuel would accept the deal from Kevin Hart and Mark Cuban for $500,000 and a 30% stake in Black Sands. This is not the most money that the Sharks have ever invested in a company, but the fact that a black-owned indie comic publisher was able to get on the show and prove the worth of their company to these billionaires is monumental in changing the view of black comics within the industry. You could argue with this landmark deal that it vindicated black creators not only across the country but the world. Our stories are worth something, and we should be given the chance to succeed just like our white counterparts. This means succeeding in the comic world and on the big screen. If you didn't know before, black-owned comic publisher Godhood Comics had their series The Antagonist acquired for a TV adaptation mid-2021. The currently three-issue series was given the opportunity of a lifetime, and it was very well deserved. The Antagonist series lives in the same universe of Godhood's previous creations, but has been their most popular by far, crossing boundaries and creating new landmarks. Godhood Comics is another company pushing back against the status quo. Both Godhood Comics and Black Sands Entertainment created their success through crowdfunding. Black Sands for the past 6 years have done multiple campaigns on WeFunder to raise money for their brand. By making each person who pledges money to Black Sands an investor, they've raised over $2 million and have 5,000 plus investors. And that's without the $500,000 they got from Shark Tank. Godhood has had multiple successful campaigns through Kickstarter, giving them the ability to continually create engaging and amazing comics for us all to enjoy. This is all to say that the demand, skill, and profitability for black comics and black-owned indie comics exists and is thriving. Anybody who tells you differently is perpetuating the same big lie that the big comic companies have been pushing for years now. And I was focused on black indie publishers, but Bitterroot, a comic made by an all-black outfit at Image Comics, will be receiving a live action courtesy of producer Ryan Coogler and director Regina King. Also, finally, we'll be seeing Milestone Comics' own Static on the big screen being produced by Michael B. Jordan. This is the beginning of the end for black creators being shut down and tossed aside within the comics industry. Instead, we're creating our own and pushing the medium to new heights. So get aboard or get left behind. Now, before I move on, I can't talk about success in moving the culture without mentioning Weird Enough Productions. Created in 2014 by Tony Weaver Jr., he created the company to empower youths who looked like and felt like him when he was younger. The only book that Weird Enough currently produces is The Uncommons, an award-winning series that has sold over 1 million copies. However, that's not the most important thing about the series. Tony, along with his team, has done something incredibly special with it. And that special thing is their Get Media Lit program, which combines The Uncommons with school curriculums to help young people improve their social and emotional wellness, digital citizenship, and literacy skills. They've been so successful that in 2020, they were named as the fifth nonprofit in Grant Thornton LLP's Purple Paladin Initiative. This is a program that helps emerging nonprofit organizations move from startup to sustainable by providing funding, business advice, and volunteer support, while also helping them share their stories more broadly. By embracing himself and extending himself to others who were just like him, Tony has created one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. And he promises that as long as you also embrace who you are, you're never too weird. you're just weird enough. If you think that's all I have for black indie comic publishers, then you might want to stick around a little longer. Although not every black indie publisher has been given grand deals like Godhead Comics, or been on national television like Black Sands, they've still been pushing boundaries and creating stories well worth the read. So, I thought as part of my last words, I'd give you some promising up-and-comers to check out who have been showing their worth issue by issue, volume by volume. Concept Moon Studios is not only a phenomenal publishing company, but it's also the YouTube page that you're watching this video on. They've had multiple successful Kickstarter campaigns and currently have 12 books in publication that you can read digitally or buy physically through their website. And I promise you that I'm not contractually obligated to say this, but their books are really good. Wingless Entertainment is a multimedia company that is focused on bringing diversity to fantasy and science fiction. They've done this by publishing 6 comics that are filled with diverse and interesting casts. These stories will leave you wanting more, and for that you can turn to their Kickstarter, which they've also had many successful campaigns through. I wonder if you guys can, you know, sense a pattern coming here. Be sure to head over to their website and check out what they have to offer. Unique Studios is anything but a small publisher. Dedicated to creating African-inspired stories across multiple mediums, they've been largely successful with becoming a cornerstone in the Black indie experience. Founder, owner, and creative director Roy Okup created the award-winning and critically acclaimed Malika Warrior Queen animated short, and created the critically acclaimed EXO, The Legend of Whale Williams Part 1. He's won multiple awards for his stories, and the two I mentioned are just 2 out of 5 books that make the universe. Not the universe, but the universe. So don't be shy and go give them a look as soon as you can. Keep It Concrete is the motto for Concrete Comics. Their mission is to tell stories through a diverse lens that appeals to all audiences of all ages, breaking boundaries and stereotypes, daring to be different. And they do just that with a lineup of 6 different comics that you can read digitally or buy physically through their website. I gotta admit, Concrete is one of my favorites with some amazing art. So if you aren't checking them out, you're only doing yourself a disservice. Now for those more inclined to the Japanese style of comic books, aka manga, Saturday AM has you on lock. They actually have 4 different properties, each focused on a different manga genre. Saturday AM and Saturday Afternoon handle shonen. Saturday PM has seinen, and Saturday Brunch is the Josei hotspot. Created in 2013 by Frederick L. Jones, his earliest memories of comics, anime, and cartoons would inspire him later in life to create Saturday AM, as a place where diverse stories are told by people around the world. Content is serialized on a bi-weekly basis, similar to Shonen Jump, but in a comic book anthology magazine form. If this sounds interesting to you, be sure to give them a look. Lastly, I want to talk about Studio Maho, another manga-style publisher, but one that is just getting its feet squarely off the ground. Founded by Patrick Thomas and Ayinde Hall, they've created 2 very entertaining series in God Punch and Blade Titans. Patrick aims to create a story that can rival Dragon Ball, and in God Punch, he might have a contender. These 2 series for them are just a starting line with the finish nowhere in sight. You can read both of their stories on Webtoons and get physicals through monthly drops on their website. This may be all the publishers I have for you all in this video, but rest assured that there's many more out there and many more getting ready to begin. So keep your eyes peeled. You never know when one could spring up. Black indie publishers over the past few years have been growing en masse, ready to take on all the challenges ahead of them. With the groundwork laid by their creative forefathers, their dominance is at hand. Be ready and prepared for the Black indie comics domination, because it's coming, whether you want it to or not.